And Counselor Watson?
Here.
Counselor Reed did send a letter to the chair stating her regret that she could not be here tonight. I believe it's the first meeting that she's missed in her whole term. She was committed due to a mix-up in time to speak at her son's college. I believe the first order of business is the swearing in of Counselor-elect Penny Carson. Madam Clerk.
Raise your right hand, repeat after me. I solemnly swear.
I solemnly swear.
That I will support the Constitution.
That I will support the Constitution.
And will obey the laws of the United States.
And will obey the laws of the United States.
And of the state of Maine.
And of the state of Maine.
That I will.
That I will.
In all respects.
In all respects.
Observe the provisions.
Observe the provisions.
Of the Charter and the ordinances.
Of the Charter and the ordinances.
Of the Town of Cape Elizabeth.
Of the Town of Cape Elizabeth.
And statutes of the state of Maine.
And statutes of the state of Maine.
And will faithfully discharge.
And will faithfully discharge.
The duties of the office.
The duties of the office.
Of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council.
Of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council.
Congratulations.
Penny, on behalf of the sitting council, welcome. I'd also like to say thank you on behalf of all the councilors for the other individuals who ran for council that were not elected, but it's only because of the efforts of those individuals running for town council that this town gets an opportunity to hear the issues that concern all our citizens. So for those of you who ran and were not successful, I hope you run again. And Penny, we are delighted to have you.
Thank you very much.
The Pledge of Allegiance to the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Henry, what are you doing with that state of Maine flag over there?
Preserving it for posterity, Mr. Chairman.
That's good. The next order of business is to welcome our student representatives, Vince Faraday and Matt Martin. This is a program that the town council has seen fit to initiate, whereby students would have representation here in the council. They're non-voting members, but their input is very much appreciated, and I look forward to hearing from both of you when you have meaningful things to say, and we all look forward to that. So welcome. I'm glad you're here. We have citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Is there any citizen that wishes to discuss a matter that is not on the agenda tonight? Mike, I sort of like this better with those lights off.
Lighting.
Hearing none, we're moved.
There is one.
Oh, I'm sorry. Come right to the podium. And if you'd state your name and your address.
My name is Valerie Hall, 45 Broad Cove Road. I wanted to present to you tonight some petitions that some of us have gotten on the issue of the lot next to the town hall that presently has the garage. And if you don't mind, I'm just going to read a few thoughts I put down. Cape Elizabeth really has such natural, beautiful natural resources, but our town center could be a lot more attractive. We're in the fortunate position of already owning a key piece of property in the town center, and we feel it would not be wise to sell it. We have a town center plan, and I would hope that we would also have a vision of an attractive, inviting town center. A town green beside the town hall would go a long way toward that vision, and it's a very New England thing to have a town green. Unlike so many towns, we do at least have a true center. It would be wise and foresighted for the town to own property in its center. We need to keep in mind that our town is growing and space is already tight. I know I worked on the book sale at the library, and We were in desperate need of a place to store books. We were working in a teeny little room, and the Arts Commission has a closet for an office. So I think with the town growing that at some point we're going to need more space. It isn't inconceivable that we might need to add to the town hall at a future date. And this piece of property would allow that expansion, which is a much better solution than a building 10 miles down the road, because that's where we could find an affordable piece of property. We've all seen those towns where the high school's 20 miles over here and community center's 10 miles over there, and they don't have a nice town center. We're fortunate that we have businesses in the center of town, like the E.F. Johnson Insurance Agency, which just won an award for fixing their building, and Jonesy's with all the flowers they put out each summer. And the town itself could do its part toward beautifying the town center with a town green. And I'd just like to add that this isn't meant to be an anti-business type thing. A more attractive town center is not an anti-business idea. A center that attracts people can also attract businesses to serve those people. And I realize that at this time, money is tight. The town has to spend a great deal of money in the next few years on moving the fire department and that sort of thing. And I would like to suggest that perhaps some type of a private donation thing could be done, like the way we did Fields for Kids, just for landscaping and making this a green, where people donate maybe matching funds or whatever is a possibility. I do have here 288 signatures on this petition, and it just simply states, the town of Cape Elizabeth should retain ownership of the property at 316 Ocean House Road, north of the town hall, with the eventual goal of making it a town green. I have to apologize, it's the first time I'd ever done a petition, and I should have also had people print their names, but I didn't realize till they came back that it's sometimes hard to read, but I do have addresses and phone numbers. And I'd also like to add that the overwhelming response to this was positive. Certainly we had a few people who said no, sell it, or didn't want to sign it, but by and large it was let me sign that, and many people said let me take one and get some signatures for you. So, and we never stood, you know, had an official position by the IGA or at the dump or anything, relocation transfer station. So, I mean, I think this response means that there's a lot of community support for this idea. Thank you.
Thank you. If you would bring the petition to the clerk, that would be just fine. So the public understands that at the conclusion of this formal meeting tonight, and I do not believe with what's on the agenda this will be an incredibly long meeting, there is plans to have a informal workshop with town council to discuss this property. There certainly will be absolutely no decision made tonight. This is just a workshop. This is the beginning of this process. As I think most citizens are aware, this town truly does have process, and I think it's fair to say that there's very few decisions in this town that are made without a long considered process. But thank you very much. Now we have some presentations, and I'll go to the podium. First presentation tonight is to the Cape Elizabeth Middle School State Championship in Physical Fitness Category 3. And I believe we have some representatives from the middle school here to accept this award. All right, and why don't you tell the people at home who you are and what grade you're in?
I'm Jacqueline Crane, and I'm 7th grade vice president.
I'm Marianne Chapman, and I'm from the 8th grade, and I'm the school board rep.
On behalf of the middle school and the student council, we would like to thank the town council for presenting us with this award. Thank you.
Okay, great. Well, let me give you the award, but let me tell all the people at home what the award is. It's a plaque. It's Cape Elizabeth Town Council Resolution. Cape Elizabeth Middle School State Championship in Physical Fitness Category 3. Whereas the Cape Elizabeth Middle School has been awarded the 1997-1998 State Championship in Physical Fitness in Category 3, and whereas this award was earned as a result of over 12% of the students achieving presidential award level status, and whereas the students' commitment to physical fitness is indicative of healthy lifestyles and may well contribute to future success in other endeavors throughout their lifetimes, and whereas the Cape Elizabeth Town Council is proud of this unique achievement by our middle school students in earning the state championship, now therefore be it resolved by the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, assembled here, that we hereby congratulate the students of the Cape Elizabeth Middle School for being named state champions in the Presidential Physical Fitness Challenge, and we encourage the students to continue to practice a healthy and fit lifestyle. It's signed by all the counselors. And congratulations to the middle school, and thank you girls for coming tonight. The next award, or the presentation, Cape Elizabeth Town Council Resolution to be more specific, is for the celebration of Jonesy Service Station's 50th anniversary. And Greg, you're here tonight, right? Welcome, Greg.
Thank you.
I'm sorry that George can't be here with us too, but I know he's here with us in spirit.
Likewise.
Let me read this resolution. Cape Elizabeth Town Council Resolution, Jonesy Service Station, 50th anniversary. Whereas Jonesy Service Station is celebrating its 50th anniversary of service to its customers in Cape Elizabeth, and whereas throughout its 50 years, Jonesy's has supported numerous youth activities in the community through donations and through the use of its business for car washes, and whereas Jonesy's is a vital business in the town center, where throughout the growing season, flowers and plants are beautifully displayed in sumptuous abundance. Pretty good, huh? And whereas the motoring public has been well served by Jonesy's with quality products and with exceptional road service, now therefore be it resolved by the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, in the town council assembled, that we hereby congratulate Jonesy Service Station on 50 years of service to Cape Elizabeth, and we wish them continued business success for decades to come. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you very much to the town council and to the people of Cape Elizabeth for allowing us to reach this milestone. My dad regrets that he can't be with us to enjoy this happy occasion. And I would like to take this moment to thank Norm Jordan, who's been with us for most of the 50 years, almost 40 of them. Norm's responsible for those beautiful flowers of which you spoke. So we are grateful to him and for the people of Cape Elizabeth for allowing us to reach this incredible milestone. Thank you very much.
Thanks.
It's certainly fun for all of us in Cape Elizabeth to have a community, family-owned business. And it's these types of moments and awards that really make our town special. The next presentation is, I believe, we actually are going to get an award. And tonight we have with us James P. Upton, the Northern New England chapter of the American Planning Association. And we also have our town planner here tonight, Maureen O'Mara. And why don't both of you come forward? And I'm just going to turn the podium over to you, Jim.
Thank you, Chairman Groff, council members, members of the public. It's a real honor for me to be here. My name is Jim Upham. I'm the planning director in Bath. But I'm here tonight representing the Northern New England chapter of the American Planning Association. That's an organization of professional planners from Maine, New Hampshire, and Vermont, local planners, state planners, regional planners, and planning consultants. I'm here tonight to give an award, as Chairman Groff said, to the town of Cape Elizabeth for the Cape Elizabeth zoning ordinance. A few months ago, the council adopted a new zoning ordinance that is going to become a model for Northern New England planners. It started out as a project to make a more user-friendly, innovative ordinance, and ended up doing that and also implementing most of the newly adopted comprehensive plan for the town of Cape Elizabeth. The zoning ordinance has some very innovative regulatory features to it. It encourages open space development in a certain part of the community. It has an innovative approach to home occupations, which is a lifestyle that all of us are very used to and many ordinances don't treat appropriately. The public participation portion of this project really is a lesson for all planners. Town council established a committee that met over a two-year period, many meetings, over three dozen meetings, I understand, and the Northern New England chapter membership believes that the town of Cape Elizabeth deserved this award, not only for the process, but also for the product that came out of that. The zoning ordinance is a clearly written, well-formatted document. There are illustrations in the document that make some very difficult planning regulations easy to understand. And I believe that this document is going to become a model for many of us in Maine and probably all of Northern New England. In fact, I understand that neighboring South Portland is going to be using some pieces and some ideas from this ordinance. And personally, I find the ordinance a very big help. I'm in the process of updating Bath's ordinance at the present time, and we'll be using some ideas, some formatting ideas, and some layout ideas, and even some regulatory ideas from the document. It was well put together, and you should be very proud of this zoning ordinance. And having said that, I want to give this plaque. Says 1998 Outstanding Planning Project Award to the town of Cape Elizabeth for the Cape Elizabeth Zoning Ordinance. Congratulations.
Thank you very much. And Maureen, come right in here. Nice. Maureen is a huge part of us receiving this award, and I'm going to give it to you. I'd also at this time, though, like to thank all the citizens of Cape Elizabeth that served on the notorious Zork Committee, and that's what this is, and the prior town councilors who spent an awful lot of time, and our current council members who voted for this ordinance and spent a lot of time attempting to improve the various drafts. No ordinance is perfect, but I believe that this was a document that was well thought out with input from all and probably satisfies no one perfectly, but that's the political process, and it was a great effort. And thank you very much, Maureen.
Thank you.
Just wanted to add one more piece to that. I want to thank Jim, first of all, for coming to the meeting. But, you know, Chairman Groff mentioned, you know, obviously the dedication of Maureen and the members of the committee on that. We also were greatly assisted by a South Portland firm on that project, Planning Decisions. When we first started working with them, the project lead was Evan Rickert, who later became the director of the State Planning Office, and he was succeeded on the project by Mark Ironman of Planning Decisions, and they worked very closely with the town and certainly share this award with us for their exceptional assistance to Cape Elizabeth throughout this project. So I want to congratulate Maureen, the Zoning Ordinance Rewrite Committee, and Evan and Mark as well for their role in this. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilors' reports and correspondence. Councilor Barry.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I serve on the county, the Cumberland County Budget Advisory Committee, and I can see budget creep coming along each year, and it has been a difficult year to deal with. We've had a lot of meetings this summer into the fall to try to work on the county budget that would keep down the tax rate, and we have some good news and some bad news. The good news, I think, is that the proposed tax decrease will be about 4.9%. There have been some increased valuations in properties in the various communities, and that assists in reducing the overall tax rate. The county budget then will result, putting surplus into the mix will result in a tax reduction this year, we hope. And the county commissioners are about to vote on that in the next month or so, because their fiscal year is the calendar year, so it will be the year 1999, unlike Cape Elizabeth, which runs from July through June. I just note for the folks at home that debt service is 15% of our expenditures in the county. That is a $2,867,815 is required just for debt service, for paying the interest on outstanding bonds that we have, and bonded indebtedness. The cost of running the county in 1997 was $16.5 million. The cost in 1998 was $17.8 million. And in 1999, it is estimated that it will cost $18,700,000. That's for the county offices, the district attorney, the emergency management agency, the registry of deeds, registry of probate, and so on, and the sheriff and the jail. And it's interesting, I think, to note that in 1997, the sheriff budget was $8.9 million. In 1998, it went up to $9.9 million. And in 1999, the budget request is $10.7 million. And that's a lot of money. And last year, I believe, Mr. Manager, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think it was $551,000 that the town of Cape Elizabeth paid to the county. Is that approximately accurate? And I think that because of the increased valuation, we may receive a slight decrease in the tax this year, although I think that the county commissioners should keep the expenditures under control. And toward that end, three of us, out of the five who attended a recent meeting, voted to request that the county commissioners reduce their proposed 5% increase in the expenditures for the coming year to 4%. And that was that motion was carried. So that was the motion of the Budget Advisory Committee that was carried. We think that they're just spending money out of sight here in the sheriff's department, in the jail. It just costs too much money to run, and you have to reach a point somewhere where you have to say enough. I think the jail had color television before I had it in my home, and so forth. So these are just some of the figures and facts that I wanted to report as a member of this Budget Advisory Committee to let the folks know what's going on at the county level. That's about it, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilor.
Mm-hmm.
Other councilors' reports and or correspondence? I have a few things. One was a couple weeks ago. Don Stevenson concluded his walk to the light here at Portland Headlight. This was an individual who left the left coast and came to the East Coast, walked all the way for Alzheimer's. He was trying to increase awareness of Alzheimer's, and when he came to Maine, the Maine Alzheimer's Association sponsored his reception here. I'd like to thank our fire department and police department for their assistance in making his victory celebration here at the Portland Headlight meaningful and appropriate. It was an experience for me. My father died of Alzheimer's, and I was touched by this man's efforts to raise awareness concerning this disease. If any of you wish to contribute, you can contribute to the Alzheimer's Association in the main chapter and simply say that you were moved by Don Stevenson's Walk to the Light. Two other matters. One, the Facilities 2000 Committee is meeting tomorrow at 7 o'clock at the Public Works Building. As most of you, I hope, know by now, this is the committee that is in charge of the design of a Levitt property that has been purchased next to the transfer station, and also is in charge with consultants of coming up with the design for moving public works to that property and moving the fire department to the public works building and renovating the police station. The public is welcome to attend these meetings. This meeting is at the facility so we can get a better understanding of the needs. This is a very important committee, and the members of this committee are working very hard. The other thing I'd like to comment on is to thank the citizens of Cape Elizabeth on behalf of the town council for approving the pool. It was about a 75% majority. You will recall that the pool renovation was unanimously supported by each and every member of the town council. It was great to see our citizens come out and vote and exercise their voice as citizens of our fine town.
Joe, can I just comment a little further? I don't know if you're going to, but I'd like to compliment our town clerk for handling Election Day for the quote-unquote low voter turnout. I expected to be in and out very quickly, which I was. However, it was very crowded down there, and the town clerk expedited matters, kept people moving, and I think it went very well for such a low voter turnout.
Might have been low for other towns, but not for us.
Mr. Chairman, I would like to say that I voted for the pool, and the whole council voted for the pool, and I'm glad that the people voted for the pool, because if I saw one more roadside sign that said, support the pool, I think we'd be investigated by the Attorney General for trying to establish a lottery to lower the tax rate.
Well, are there any other reports and correspondence? Hearing none, then we'll move forward to the town manager's report. Mr. McGovern.
The council has done a good job covering most everything I was going to cover, so I'll make this brief. I do want to thank all the citizens for cooperation with Cleanup Week. For the first time, we tried the experiment of having biodegradable bags, and there were 13,000 of them that were picked up at the transfer station. Bob Malley, our director of Public Works, has indicated that there were only about 24 homes that initially put out plastic. Out of all the different homes that participated in Cleanup Week. So that was very successful with the cooperation of the citizens, with the encouragement of the Recycling Committee, and with the very good efforts of the members of the Department of Public Works who pick up all the material and make it successful. Also, two other projects that are quite visible on one end of town I did want to make mention of, over by the Spurwing Church and the Riverside Cemetery. It looked the other day as if a pickup truck had driven through the Spurwing Church. If you look at the way the tarp was there at the back of a cart, well, actually, that was a cart picking up roofing materials, and the town council during the budget process had approved some work to be done on that roof. When we took off the shingles, as we expected and as was budgeted, we found that the original boards that were placed up to support the roof were, in fact, rotted. They had been up there since 1834, and we are replacing them with in-kind boards, only new ones. that look, essentially look the same and are of the same material as was made in 1834, figuring if the first job lasted 150 years, we could try to make a similar effort. Ernie McVane, quite hard on that, as well as the contractor, and it appears to be under budget, and is a good project and one that really preserves that important structure. Right next door to the cemetery, the expansion is now underway somewhat earlier than we had planned. It was early approved by the town council, but we'd expected the job to be done during the middle of winter, and the contractor was able to get there earlier. Deborah Lane's worked quite hard on that, and Bob and others, the Riverside Cemetery trustees, and really pleased that is moving. Beyond that, I would like to mention that department heads have been asked to submit suggestions for the capital improvement plan for the years 2000 to 2004, no later than December 1 of 1998. So similarly, if there's any council members, any members of the public that would like to see projects considered for that document, it'll actually be prepared during the month of December and submitted to the council in January. Now is the time, if you have project ideas, it's a good time to let me know so they can be considered for inclusion in the capital improvement plan. Thank you.
I forgot one thing, and that it's not very often that we have someone publish a book about property in our town homes, and I think it's worthy of note. This book is called Portland Headlight in Fort Williams, an illustrated history with a walking guide map by Kenneth E. Thompson, Jr. It's a fabulous book, and I hope, I don't know, I hope we have a copy in the library.
We do, and we also have them for sale at the museum at Portland Headlight Gift Shop, still open weekends.
Right.
Merry Christmas gift, stocking stuffer.
A wonderful stocking stuffer for those of you who want to know more about your town's heritage. And I think all of us in the council recommend this purchase.
We'll pass it around to folks, so we'll see.
Next, we have the minutes of the October 12th, 1998 meeting. Is there a motion to approve?
I move that the minutes of the October 12th meeting be approved.
Chairman Groff, I'd like to make one note about the minutes. It doesn't designate that I was present at that meeting, and I think that that should be due noted, and then I would second Henry's motion.
Oh, I see. The X got left out in presence.
Oh.
And we all know you were there.
I was there.
All right.
Madam Clerk, I assume you can make that change?
I certainly will.
Any other corrections or additions to the minutes? Hearing none, all in favor? Opposed? It's unanimous, 6-0. Item number 60. Report of the Appointments Committee.
Mr. Chairman, the chairperson is out tonight, so Council Watson, you want to announce these? Or?
Certainly. The Appointments Committee had the following openings. We had an opening for the Personnel Appeals Board and have nominated Janet McLaughlin to serve on that committee. We had an opening on the Recycling Committee. Julia Beckett has been appointed to that committee. Historic Preservation Study Committee, Nancy Harvey, we have appointed to that committee. Also, the Historic Preservation Study Committee, Connie Jordan, has been appointed as well to that committee.
And I assume what you're requesting is that the town council by motion approve the appointment.
Yes, that's right? Exactly what I'm suggesting.
I'll second the motion.
And it's been moved and seconded to approve the various appointments stated by the councilor. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor? Opposed? It's unanimous. You know, this is scary. Ever since I came back as chairman, we've had a long string of unanimous votes. I probably mellowed with my time off.
Evening,
it could change.
Yeah, that's right. It could change. Item 61, request for quitclaim deed for 16 Hanniford Cove Road. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, this is a quitclaim deed request, all our records show that the taxes were paid. However, we want to be sure that the record is clear, that the property is about to change hands. And, this is a really a pro forma action. We do not show any indebtedness at all.
Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Second by Councilor McGinty. Any further discussion? Hearing none. All in favor? Opposed? 6-0. Item number 62, request to abate personal property taxes. Mr. McGovern.
Yeah, the town clerk, in her capacity as deputy tax collector, was looking at all the personal property tax accounts and discovered two of properties that are no longer in business in the town. It's very difficult to collect these, if not impossible, and she is recommending, and I agree, that they be abated. It's to the former Four Seasons Travel for $25.76, and an outfit called Tip to Toe, 2 years of taxes, one for $27.84 and one for $28.62. All three abatements are for less than a total of $100.
Is there such a motion? Councilor Berry?
I wanted to ask a question.
Well, why don't we have a motion first, and then we could, is there such a motion?
I move the question.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Discussion?
Four Seasons Travel, it says 0298. Does that mean 1998?
This is the second payment for the fiscal year 1998, which was the October 97 payment, and the 02 would be for the April of 98
maybe. I see. These businesses were here, though, when the taxes were accrued?
They were here as of April 1 of the tax year.
Are they still solvent and available?
No, they're no longer in business.
Oh, okay.
Four Seasons Travel had an unfortunate incident, and I'm not sure of the tip-to-toe situation. Not even sure what tip-to-toe is.
I think we can say with certainty, though, it would cost more to collect than we would get.
That's right.
Further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Yeah.
Opposed? Passes 6-0. Item 63, review of plans for library parking lot expansion. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, I think everyone's aware that several years ago the town bought the lot immediately in back of Dr. Dickinson's office. It's immediately adjacent to the library. For those of you that attend library programs, you'll note that oftentimes the parking lot is overcrowded. They're parked in the line zone where folks aren't supposed to be parked, and it gets rather difficult. That was the reason the town council purchased this lot. Bob Malley, Jay Shermer, town engineer Steve Harding, Maureen O'Meara, and I have had several meetings go with drafts of different plans of how we might accomplish parking on this lot. What the process has come up with is an expansion that will add a net of 17 additional parking spaces to 39 that exist now. The estimated cost, we've been listing a cost, but we never had a budget estimate done, of $35,000. Once it was designed, they actually did a cost estimate, came out with about $37,000. 200. This does include not only the parking spaces, but all of the landscaping. There's going to be some deciduous trees, some evergreen trees. It'll also include three benches to make it, you know, pedestrian friendly. There's been a lot of attention and concern and debate as to where these benches go and other issues, but I think we're all satisfied at the staff level that they are adequate. This In approving the plans this evening, this would not be the final vote of the town council. This would simply authorize us to file the application to the planning board. You haven't appropriated any money for this yet. The plan would be, at this point in time, to include it in the capital improvement plan and to put it in next year's budget. I'll publicly say, by voting to submit this application, you are in no way indicating or implying that you will approve the final budget for this in next year's budget or wherever it comes forward. This simply puts the approval in place, or would put the approvals in place, subject to fiscal votes later on.
Is there a motion by a councillor to authorize the filing of this plan with the planning board? So. Councillor Berry, is there a second? Councillor Carson, discussion.
Chairman Graf, I am in favor of this plan. However, I'm not in favor of some of the costs that are in this plan. We will get 17 additional parking spaces. By doing this, we are going to have to give up 4 of the existing ones. But if you take the cost of this budget and you divide it by 17 additional spaces, we're paying $2,177 for additional space. That's a lot. I understand the need for this. However, I think there are some things in this line item that need to be closely looked at. Item number 10, plantings of $8,400. I think that the original budget of $35,000 was probably a right-on budget. I think we need to tweak some of these numbers. I think we could reduce some of the plantings and get this back within the original budget estimate of $35,000. I'd be a lot more comfortable with that, as seems to be precedent here. We always have an inclusive 10% contingency, and yet we're now asking for more money for this project. The other thing is the pattern pavement, the brick finished appearance of the pavement. I don't know how much additional cost that is, but I think that just regular pavement and sidewalk material would be fine. We might be able to find the additional cost savings there as well. As I said, I'm in favor of this. I think that we need the additional spaces and we need to landscape it in an appropriate way. However, I think we need to tighten these numbers.
If I might respond to that, these numbers do anticipate an outside contractor doing all of the work. We would plan to do a lot of this work with our own crews,
okay,
therefore bringing the cost back within the original budget estimate.
Okay.
Councilman McGinty.
I'm going to be opposing this. I voted against this in the first place when we had our discussions on it earlier. You know, we just got presented with a petition for people who want to preserve open space. This is town-owned open space. There's been other suggestions on how this property could be used, including for a teen center, ironically enough, has been discussed next door. I'm a strong supporter of the library, always have been. This is not reflective on library or library services, but I think that this property could be better used, and I believe the expense, as Councilor Watson so eloquently described, is way out of line. And so I'm going to be opposing this.
Council.
I'm wondering how many times it is that we have overflow from the current parking lot, the reason we're feeling we need this extra space.
We quite often, particularly when we have story hour for preschool children, whenever we offer the library the community room for many different meetings. It's also used in the evenings for overflow for school events. And what we've been finding is that they've been parking in Dr. Dickinson's lot, and then his customers are unable then to get into his lot. That begins to begin the problem. You know, we haven't gone to the expense of doing estimates, but certainly, I could ask the library personnel when they have different events to go out and to count the number of spaces that are available. We haven't done that as of yet. But it's by, certainly anecdotally, we see lots of occasions at the library. And I was there election night. I don't know how many of you were there for the opening of the art show. Mm-hmm. But there was absolutely no parking. It was not a good situation. We have those types of events, usually several times a month that we're overflowing parking here.
Because I didn't notice any lack of parking that night, but that was, just a couple of occasions. But I would agree with Councilor Watson's two items. They were the two that I was concerned about. The pattern paving didn't seem that necessary. And the plantings, I think that the town doesn't always pay enough attention to landscaping and what it can do to make a project look well, but when I look at the selection of trees, I think we could add some smaller shrubs mixed in with the selection could lower the cost, actually provide a better buffer for cars and things like that. So I'd like to look at that sort of thing.
Further comment? Obviously, this vote tonight is not up or down on this project. It's simply to authorize the filing of this plan with the planning board. There's certainly no binding vote on this council as to any cost of any kind, and no binding vote of this council that this project will ever go forward. So with those caveats, is there further discussion? Hearing none. All in favor? Raise your hands, please. 1, 2, 3, 4. Opposed? 4-2. I knew my
story. Sorry, I was just going to say sorry about that, Joe.
So it's simply, we have authorized filing this plan with the planning board, but Mr. McGovern, I think it would behoove the staff to take note of some potential problems down the road.
Duly noted.
Item 64, request to eliminate fee for road races benefiting nonprofits. Mr. McGovern.
This is the one I expected would break your string. Council initiated a number of fees a couple of months back. Most of them have gone in quite well. I think it's important when we get real strong negative feedback on something that we relate back to the town council. In this instance, I think everyone looked at the road rates fee and thought, oh, here's the beach to beacon. You know, they're loaded with money. You know, there's that perception, whether or not it's true or not. You know, that obviously, in addition to recovering all the expenses, they should be charged. Well, what we ended up discovering was real strong opposition to folks that wanted to do the small types of road races that benefited specific charities. For instance, we got a call from the town of Scarborough. And their community liaison officer in the school department was working with some kids in, I believe it was at the middle school, it might have been the high school, and the kids had agreed that they wanted to do a charity walk for AIDS. And unfortunately, this fell under the requirement for this fee, and with the chief of police needing to give permits for road races and processions is the provision within the rules. We had another one for the turkey trot for the main track club. This is something that's happened in Cape Elizabeth, I think, for like 25 years, and they were quite taken aback because all the money goes to charity that we were starting to charge them $100. Obviously, you know, if the council wants to keep this fee into place, you know, that's fine. But, you know, when we heard the vociferous complaints and the fact that, you know, it was involving my time, the chief's time, you know, it became questionable whether or not it was really worth the town's while to charge this fee. But I would defer, and I'm not a strong advocate for eliminating the fee, but I did want you to know that the group specifically asked, particularly the second one, would the council revisit this, and I said I'd bring the matter to your attention and let them know what you've decided.
And obviously you prepared a memorandum for the council. I would like to inquire as to what the rationale was to have the chief of police be the individual who was put in the hot seat about whether to charge the $100 fee or not for an organization, rather than our town manager, whose job it seems more appropriate for you to do that.
It was simply because he is the officer of the town who issues the permits, and you know, there wasn't a peer review put in. There could have been. There just wasn't in this instance. It could be me, but that's just more.
Doesn't it allow an out when it's one level above the person issuing the permit, so that then if it's decided not to do that, we don't have a situation with the citizens and the chief of police. Instead, we have a situation with the citizens and the town manager, who is much more used to dealing with those issues.
That would be fine, sir. I would like to also point out that all road races would still be responsible for any out-of-pocket expense for the town. For example, the road race was, you know, in the many, many thousands of dollars, and those expenses still need to be paid. This is just an add-on fee in addition to all the out-of-pocket expenses.
Councilor Fritz.
But if I remember our reasoning for having fees was that these events would not cost the taxpayers of the town anything, but that they would actually cover the expense of not having the race, because that would be paid for by the organization, but in looking over, say, if there was a new race and they were coming to get a permit, and how much time would it take the employee of the town to do that. So I think there, it's not totally free. And that was the point to setting up these fees, was to cover the cost.
I have purposely not asked for a motion, because I think in a situation like this where there's not a specific recommendation and it's still discussion, it would be more appropriate to have some discussion before we had a motion. So that's procedurally why we're going this way. Councilor McGinty.
I agree with pretty much what Councilor Fritz said. The purpose, this was more or less a processing fee. Is that correct? And I guess my question is, what is the actual processing? Does somebody walk in, fill out a piece of paper, hand the police chief, and the police chief puts on his, the crown of wisdom or whether, and says yes or no? What is the actual, what processing is there? Does he actually have to go out and check out? If it's a new, particularly if it's a new race, not somebody we've been dealing with like a turkey trot for years, but a new organization that comes in, does he have to actually do any physical processing of paperwork or anything?
In most instances, what this is a situation where requires someone to submit it in writing. He would stamp approved and sign his name. Certainly if it's a significant road race, such as the Beach Beacon was, that required an enormous amount of time. And mostly, the council sees a lot of them too. You have all these charity walks from SMTC to Fort Williams that come through in the spring. There's usually five or six of them, some of which are so small we don't bring to the council even, but nonetheless, under this policy, they'd all be required to pay $100. There's a crop walk that the different churches do that runs from, I think, from SMTC to Fort Williams. They'd be required to pay this fee.
Councilor McGinn?
Could I ask another question? It says that the police chief has authorized to waive this fee for any group that will be donating $100 or more to charity. How does he determine that?
You ask. The honor system.
Further discussion. I would like to have the sense of the councilors, if in fact there was going to be a motion in this regard, whether other councilors believe that it would be more appropriate for the town manager to exercise this discretion or the chief of police. Does anybody have any thoughts in that area?
Chairman Groff, I think that I agree with you regarding, I'd like to see the town manager exercise this if possible, or Deb Lane when she stands in for him. I'm really torn on this issue regarding, and that's why I haven't said anything today, hoping that as I'd become enlightened as more of the counselors spoke. It seems to me that to charge a fee for a race that 100% of the proceeds go to charity is a reasonable thing to do, to waive that fee as long as all of our other costs are covered. However, there are fees or are costs associated with processing this, and how do we recoup those? I'm also torn with, do we have them pay the fee and then the town of Cape Elizabeth make a donation? Then my gut level feeling is that I like that better than the others. So I'm all over the board on this one. I don't have a definite feel one way or the other.
Councilman McGinn.
I would like to see us charge what it costs to process the pay, whatever the administrative cost is of processing the application, whatever that is. If it's $25, I can live with that. If it's 50 or whatever. It's probably, if on these regular routine ones we get, it's certainly probably not $100. But if there is some processing fee, and I hate to sound like Grinch, even though it's for charity, it still costs the taxpayers something to process the paperwork. And as minimal as we can make that, I think we should.
And
with the provision that if the charity is, that the town manager could waive it, in his judgment, for some, that the cost of the town is so minimal that it's not worth processing the $25 check. It costs more to process a $25 check than to do the paperwork or something like that.
Well, how about the concept that the town manager is empowered to waive the fee as long as in the town manager's, at the town manager's discretion, with the understanding that the town manager will endeavor to cover any processing cost by any application. And that way, you know, he can charge a sliding scale on something that is appropriate in that particular instance. But with the guidance from the council, that we anticipate that his discretion would be limited by the council's desire to cover the processing fee.
I can live with that.
Councilor Frick?
I'm thinking that the police chief might be the proper person, since their personnel might be called on to direct traffic, to ask the questions about, not that you can't, but this size of the race. And I think they'd have a handle on what the problems might be with different size races. So,
I understand, but there would be nothing that would keep the chief of police from communicating that to the town manager.
But it seems more direct, I guess.
Well, that was, quite frankly, that was my reason for not having the chief of police do it, because it seems to me it puts him in a box with the citizens that he's serving, and one level away from the person issuing the permit, in my opinion, many times is a good insulator and allows someone who is whose job really it is to make those decisions, to make those decisions. But I think it's probably, does anybody have a motion at this point in time, or would you like to continue this discussion?
Chairman Graf, I would like to ask our student representatives if they have any input they would like to give on this subject that might be helpful.
That's fine. What do our student representatives think about this issue?
In regards of waiving the fee, or in regards of having the town manager or the chief of police?
Both.
I personally believe that the it should be at the discretion of the town manager, and whether it be the chief of police or not. It personally, it doesn't really matter to me.
That's honest.
I'm thinking along those lines that whether it's the town manager or the chief of police is responsible, I think that there's going to be a certain level of communication between the two anyway. Whether it's the person, whether it's the chief of police who's going to be overseeing the event, or the town manager who officially has to be notified, I think that either way, it's those two, you know, their responsibility to look after that. So I guess I have no opinion on that. I'm wondering, though, if the discussion is about, correct me if I'm wrong, I don't think it's constitutional right to use the roads to walk in like a, in a, it's not really a demonstration, but in a procession of this sort. Are we talking about the cost of the processing fees? I'm not exactly sure what the processing fees are as far as the official documentation needed for a walk like this. That's just the one thing I'm confused on. I'm not sure if you guys could.
Well, I'm sure you're not alone.
Yeah.
Mr. McGovern, what would you construe to be processing fees?
Let me answer Mr. Faraday's first comment about constitutional right. These processions are, in fact, a constitutional right, and that's why we have a provision for a permit so that within the constitutional right, we do protect the wider interests of the town. As to the proper level of a processing fee, again, it depends on, as I think Councillor Fritz, Councillor McGinty said, Councillor Fritz, the level of involvement as to whether or not the police, you do need to look at sending out the route. Most of these types of events require a minimal of processing. It probably like 5 minutes of the chief's time in no amount of my time. So, you know, we're looking at, you know, a minimal amount of like $10 for processing for most of these.
Is there a motion? Councilor Carson.
I move that the manager be the last stop for processing the fees. He's the one that can reflect the role of the council. It's the council that's making this decision. So I don't think you can ask the police chief to try and wonder what the council's position is, since he's not here at our processes. So I'd like to see the manager deal with this issue, because he knows what we're thinking about, and where this conversation came from to start with.
And as far as the amount of the fees, what's that part of your motion?
Well, I think $100 seems a little steep for most small crop walks. Maybe that's not a small one, but some. I wasn't here for the previous discussion, so I'm in no way trying to say what how you arrived at your original $100 fee. But it does seem a little bit high to me, especially if there is in many of them hardly any processing costs. I would think the big cost would be if you have to move any traffic, put any signs up, take any people off roads, take, you know, whatever those kinds of things are. That would definitely be a fee that would be worth, because we'd be having to pay the police department. And I guess the manager would have to use some discretion. But I think, I don't want to say that the fee should be lowered below $100, because you all set that fee for whatever reason you did in your previous discussion. So I guess I'm not going to comment on $100 because I wasn't here for that part of it. But it certainly seems that we could get on with this by just asking the manager to be the one to oversee the fees, or oversee the permits.
All right, but the manager has put this before the council for two purposes. One, not really who would do it, that came up tonight. But the other purpose was to allow the manager discretion. And would it be part of your motion to allow the manager discretion to reduce the fee if he believed it was appropriate and the processing cost was going to be covered, in his opinion?
Yes.
All right. Is there a second to that motion?
Second.
Second by Councilor Watson. Further discussion on the motion. Councilor McGinty.
Could we make that amendment to make it like between $10 and $100? Would that be acceptable?
Sure.
Yes.
That's fine. The motion has been amended by consent. Further discussion.
I don't want to dwell on this a terribly long time, but I mean, I'd rather see the permit fee be a flat $25 and the discretion not be, you know, a responsibility of the manager that it's just one fee for everybody.
Okay.
And that it's much lower than it is now.
Further discussion on the pending motion.
Are we adding this to the pending motion? $25 as opposed to?
No, the pending motion was $10 to $100. That was her, Councilor Fritz's position that it should be $25. If in fact the pending motion is defeated, then that motion could be voted upon. So the
I will move to amend the motion to be $25.
Huh? I won't second that.
Okay.
You will or not?
Will not.
I won't second that.
So the original motion is to have a fee of $10 to $100 at the discretion of the town manager be able to authorize, what do we call it, charity walks and road races? All in favor?
Well, you vote on the amendment.
All right. We're voting on the amendment to, well, what the amendment is, what, a flat $25 fee?
Is there a second?
No, there
was there a second to the amendment? Hearing no second, the amendment's defeated. We're back to the original motion. All in favor? Opposed? It's unanimous. 6-0. Thank you. All right.
Just overwhelmed.
And who said we can't get down to the minutia? All right. Citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda.
Yeah, we just, Mr. Chairman, after you conclude that item, we are going to go into a workshop, and then there will be another item that won't require public action. But just because when you vote to go into that item, you want to be on TV. Could I read it and then say that I want the council at the appropriate time to add something to it?
Sure.
The item 65, which will be after the workshop, will be to enter executive session to meet with town legal counsel, who's now here, to review the status of negotiations with Local 340 of the Teamsters representing public works employees, and to consider requests for a hardship abatement. At the time you actually vote on that, I'll also ask you to discuss a matter involving property disposition of a tax-acquired property.
Well, why don't we vote on that right now to authorize to go into executive session subsequent to the workshop? Is there such a motion?
So moved.
And
second.
And that motion was for the purposes stated by the town manager. It's been moved and seconded to go into executive session subsequent to the workshop on the town property next to town hall. All in favor? opposed? It's unanimous, 6-0. We are having a workshop that will not be televised. We will then be considering this substance. While we have voted, we will be in executive session. It's not anticipated that we will be coming back into public session tonight. So good night, and thank you very much.
You might vote on the hardship abatement.
We might vote on the hardship abatement, but we're not coming back on TV. Right.
Chairman Groff, may I just make a comment that Rosemary, Councilor Reed asked me to make to Greg Jones. She's very sorry that she was unable to be here. She's at her son's college. She was invited to speak at one of his classes. And she remembers when her father worked part-time at Jonesy Service Station, and she would be at school at Pond Cove or the middle school and walk up to visit her father. So she has very much sentimental memories about it, and she regrets very much that she couldn't be here.
Thank you. Good night.